stars in the sky, looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus. Look down from the sky and stay by my side till the morning is Jesus, I ask thee to stay close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care and fit us for heaven to live with thee there.
Good morning, happy Sabbath, church. We'll be studying this week's lesson is our lesson number 11. So I wanna welcome you all to our Sabbath school discussion as well as those who are joining us online. For the discussion, it'll be just a lot of questions. So we do ask when you give your response to keep them about 20, 30 seconds long. So we have enough time to be able to get to everyone during the discussion. So before we jump right in, let's all bow our heads and I'll offer a quick word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day you've given us. Thank you for the opportunity that we get to be able to come to your house to spend a few hours in your presence. And be with us now as we're studying from your word. Help us as we dive into the lesson, Lord. Help us as we've been studying missions this week and help us to be able to learn now as we're talking about the unreached. Help us to be able to learn more about you as well. Guide us in our study, and may we be blessed by what we learn. All these things I ask in your son's name, amen. So to introduce myself, I am Bincy Mathai, and our teacher for this week is...
Namaskar. I'm C.P. Matthew. We both will be discussing this today, this morning's lesson.
So as I mentioned before, this is the 11th lesson for this quarter, the final quarter of the year, and it is entitled Mission to the Unreached, Part 2. So this is, in a way, is a continuation of our study from last week, where last week we focused on Paul's mission to the unreached, and this week's focus is going to be on Christ's outreach and ministries to big cities as well as foreign places. So just to start off the study, kind of like a few rapid questions, few icebreaker questions. So if maybe just one person can answer them, and this is just to get our blood flowing through the brains. So our first rapid question, what is God's mission? So if someone has it.
To reach the unreached.
Yes. And then we had our, yes, to reach the unreached. Also seek and save the lost. Who planned out the mission?
God.
God, yes. And when was the mission planned?
Before the foundation of the world.
Yeah,
yes. Thank you, Pastor. When and where did the plan go into action?
Into action.
Into action.
Initial. Real action at the cross.
So the plan was initiated.
Yes, when did it, was it initiated?
I was just thinking about this question at the same time this morning. Sitting here, as Adventist, as before the foundation of the world, this was laid out. Mm-hmm. And all through the history, and we as the student of the prophecy, we know the great kingdoms, Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, and Rome. And we see this Greek woman coming to Jesus. I was thinking the Holy Spirit was working, putting the puzzle together from a long time. She heard about Jesus doing miracles, but who prompted her to come to Jesus? So this way, God's mission has been going on, but people were still, and the woman was the heathen and idol worshiper. And now you see the land of Canaan, God told them, we destroy everybody because their sins had come to the full. So also when we relate that, see, when sin has come to the full, God remembered her iniquities, Bible says. So the mission is given to everybody, going step by step, year by year, and people by people. Holy Spirit has been working, and now this is what we're going to study this morning, I guess.
All right, thank you for sharing. Well,
Mohan, you have said the whole lesson now. So we are looking for simple answers. God initiated this plan in the Garden of Eden in a symbolic way. That's how it is from that to start about. Though it was laid up before the foundation of the world, this plan of salvation started or initiated with when Adam sinned. God comes down and tell him what he has to do in a symbolic way. He said, what he meant was, he will come down, or his son will come down and die for them. For that whole humanity that comes after Adam will be saved. So he suggested a plan to offer a sacrifice, to kill an animal. And when we read Genesis 3:21, we see that God gave Adam and Eve clothes of skin. That represents the righteousness of Jesus Christ. They were covering their body with the fig leaves. That's not enough. So God's plan that was initiated in the Garden of Eden. Any other? It's a little theological, but what do you think, Pastor Pedro? Is that correct?
That is correct. Yeah, as God clothed them with coats of skin. So it is God's initiative.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So just a few more rapid questions. Elder Mohan John had actually given the answer to this, but when was the mission accomplished?
At the cross.
Yes, that's right, at the cross. And was this plan only for the Israelites or the Jewish nation?
The whole world.
Yes. Yes.
How do we know? When God came to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, only two people were living the world. And when we come to Abraham, he blesses them. Through Abraham, all the nations will be blessed. So that is open to all. And when we read 1 John chapter 2, verse 16, that's plan of salvation for the whole world.
Thank you. So now that those few questions were kind of now to focus us into what our lesson will be about this week for the unreached. So question for the audience, who are the unreached? Can we have a definition? Mm-hmm. Just the cities?
No, they were the unreached. Mm-hmm. Because Jewish thought that it's for them. So God is saying, Jesus said that it is for everyone. So, but the unreached the people who lived in the cities don't know anything about the real God.
The unreached are the people who have not heard about the saving grace of Jesus Christ.
Yes, so it's both in big cities, foreign areas as well. So it's a very broad definition.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All right, so the next question is for Elder Matthew. Should other nations apart from Israel be invited to the mission?
Yes. Jesus gave several examples. He went to different places other than the Commonwealth of Israel, and he preached the gospel of salvation to Gentiles. And we also see in this lesson, we'll come to that part, the Syrophoenician woman's daughter, healing of the daughter of Syrophoenician woman, and the Roman centurion are examples. They are outside the Israelites, outside of the Commonwealth of Israel. So, and last week also we heard several examples. So in this lesson, we'll see few more examples how God took this, or how Jesus took this message of hope and grace to not only to Jewish people, but also other people. In different levels of society, he takes this message. That means this gospel or the plan of salvation is all inclusive, all embracing. No one is excluded from that one.
All right. Thank you.
Any more discussion on that?
Even when you look at the genealogy of Jesus,
okay,
though he was born to Jewish parents, but you have even Gentiles in that genealogy. It just shows that God embraces the whole world.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you for sharing that point as well, Pastor. So our lesson, we focus on each day, but we'll be kind of hopping around in a not-so-linear way as the lesson studied. So we'll shift our focus to Wednesday's lesson, actually, where there was a problem with not the recipients of the word, but with the messengers. So when we study Acts, we realize there was a problem amongst the apostles. And we kind of touched on it a little bit earlier. The question to the audience is, what was Peter's problem? And this is, if you need a reference, the story is in Acts 10, verses 9 to 26. What was Peter's problem that he had?
Let's see, did he have a problem? Yes.
I think all of them had a problem.
Okay.
All the disciples, because they were raised up as Jews primarily, and the Jews always looked down upon the Gentiles as second class. And that was so greatly embedded in the minds even of Peter that he was hesitant even almost 20 years after Calvary to go and to eat with the Gentiles, to be a part of them. So maybe we need to ask that question to ourselves. Do we also have such problems?
Yeah, we are coming to that one, Pastor. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. You know, all these disciples were Jewish people. And they were brought up in the strict Mosaic law. So they have built walls and in the boundaries for each thing. And for them, talking to Gentile or going to their house were forbidden, actually. You know, this was Peter's problem. Not only Peter, the other disciples were there in this one. So God wants to open the mind of Peter. So what he did, we all know, we have studied in the... He saw a great sheet coming down from heaven, which has all kinds of animals and creatures. And God asks Peter, kill and eat. How many times? Three times. So God means something. And Peter says, no, I will not kill and eat them. They're so common and so impure. Some of them are. I can't do that as I am brought up as a Jew. Then what was God's answer? Come on.
What God has cleansed.
What God has cleansed, you cannot call the impure. What's the difference between impure and common food? Does anybody know?
Dr. Mathew, just a comment here, uh-huh. a thought. Jesus told Peter, when you are converted, strengthen your brethren. As Pastor Mike said, 20 years later, all these things happen. Could it be that he was not fully converted for Jesus to say that? And can that happen to us too?
You know, when Jesus was with the disciple, he asked Peter to feed the sheep. You remember that occasion? So it is not a question of conversion. We are converted. We all have our inhibitions. Unless we are led by the Holy Spirit, we cannot get out of these things. The favoritism, nepotism, there are so many things we can use. In a little bit here and there, we all have that one. Some of them we have even inherited. So it's hard. It's not a question of conversion. It's a question of the tradition which we have followed. I always asked my wife, why should Sabbath school be started at 9:30 all over the world? I went to different parts of the world Sabbath school. They all start at 9:30. Why? Is there any reason? It's a common practice followed by. So there are traditions. And these people are embedded in this tradition because they are brought up that way. So it is hard for them to come out of it. It takes a while. So God wanted to teach Peter. Okay, then later on, Paul was used to teach Peter. Okay, that Paul solves this issue. There was this problem in the church, apostolic church.
Okay. Yes. So to answer the question, to summarize it, the problem that Peter was having was prejudice. And that was something very common within the Jewish people, where they didn't like the Gentiles, and a big issue was circumcision as well. So there was nationalism, pride, and prejudice. Yeah.
They were told that they were the chosen generation. And they were given the law. One occasion, Jesus tells them, you're sitting on the pedestal of Moses. That's the way they phrase it. You know what is Mosaic covenant. So Jesus was critical about these things. But Jesus wanted to teach a lesson to the apostles. Not only Peter, John, and James, even Barnabas. Barnabas was with Paul. He went away with him. So this was the tradition. And Paul was a Pharisee. Paul knew that was, when he got converted, he knew what he's called for. Paul is called for the gospel or evangelizing the uncircumcised. And Peter is called for the evangelization of the circumcised. And so Paul said, we are one in Christ. All the boundaries are, broken down. When Christ died on the cross, all the boundaries are broken down. The veil was torn, and we all have the access. So this Paul understood this meaning of these things. And Paul was telling Peter, Paul confronts Peter with this issue. The issue was circumcision. They thought, the disciples thought, to be a new convert, they had to first become a Jew, then a Christian. And Paul said, it's not so. In Christ, there is no circumcision, there is no uncircumcision, there is no Jew, no Gentile, no male or no female, no bond or free. We are all one in Christ. So when Paul brought this light to the disciples, they agreed. This was the right thing. They prayed together and they continued.
think Elder John has a comment.
Yeah.
Bincy, as you mentioned, that word prejudice. Mm-hmm. Isn't that the reason why the Matthew 28 at the end, 22, whatever, 28, go into all the world, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. God did not show, Jesus did not show any prejudice there. Mm-hmm. Everybody was equal in his sight because he created everybody. So that should happen. He has given the mission to his disciples and he has given the same mission to us also.
Just like Elder Matthew said that, you know, God said there's no Jew or Greek or Gentile. All are one in the Lord. So we have, there shouldn't be any prejudice there. We're all children of God.
Yeah, this is a very sensitive issue. People have learned to think the same way they were brought up. In conversion is a change of our attitude, change of our mind, and it's a change of our leadership. That's conversion is. So this is in our mind, but we have to work on it to get rid of that. You know, once I had the privilege, I had the privilege of talking about unity in the church in Kerala, in India. And after the service, several people came and told me, you did it. Both groups came and told me, no, that's not the way to do it. But the question is the unity. Are we united in Christ? That's the question. Yes, Pastor.
Very interesting. Why through a vision of eating that God communicated this message to Peter? It was not through something else. He said, arise, kill and eat. It was metaphoric, but why through this food thing? Because in the culture, Oriental culture, even now today, to meet somebody is fine, but to eat with somebody, that was a big taboo. And that's why even in Galatians we see Peter was eating with the Gentiles until some people came, then he ran from the dining table.
Yeah.
So God, through this vision of eating, was trying to communicate to Peter, listen, everybody's equal. You can eat with them, you can stay with them. And that's how Peter, you know, it got digested in his mind.
Thank you for that.
That's a good way of praising. I didn't know that. You know, thank you, Pastor.
All right. So now that we understand that there was a sense of prejudice in the Jewish people, going back to Christ's ministry, we wonder why then Christ took a decision to travel to pagan places. So question for the audience. What was the influence that Tyre and Sidon had on Israel? So what was the history between these nations?
Teach the Jews, you should not have this prejudice. He is our Savior. They also knew by the Holy Spirit, they were looking forward to a Savior.
Thank you, Uncle. Back to the question, what was the history between the nations?
They were actually Israel's enemy at one point of time. I think in the book of Nahum, we see that they had a lot of enmity for a long time. And when Israel was captured by a foreign country, these were rejoicing.
Yes.
When these two cities were left, God could have asked David or anybody to take the cities, annex those place. Judges say these two cities were left unattacked because God wants to teach a lesson to Israelites. God wants them to evangelize that place. Instead of that one, what the Israelites did, they copied what the Gentiles were doing. And Solomon just, did that one. He just brought all those things from the Gentile nation to the Israelites. Thus he brought the apostasy to the Israelites. Solomon wanted to build the temple. For that, he wanted to have wood. So he called it to the king of Solomon, this is history, to help him with the wood. He agreed. Finally, he brought wood. Then he brought women. Then he brought to worship the foreign gods, their gods. So Solomon bought three W's from these two cities: wood, women, and worship of the pagan gods. And you know, this is a history. God wants to evangelize those cities by Israelites, but they did not do. Instead of that, they started intermarrying and were bringing their idol worship to the to Israel.
Correct. So just to summarize that, the Israelites were, instead of influencing those around them, in turn were influenced by the foreign nations, leading to, of course, apostasy. So that's the history, as Elder Matthew had mentioned. So considering this history, why then did Jesus, this is a question to the audience, why did they decide to leave Galilee and travel to these two cities, Tyre and Sidon? What was the reason? Or was there a reason, a specific reason?
God wants to save everybody, and in every city, every country, there are people who are seeking after God. And God wants to give an opportunity to everyone. See, so like previously you mentioned, Bincy, if we don't influence others, they will influence us. But we thank God Jesus is so powerful that he always influences others with good.
And also in the same context, Jesus knew what was in man. The Holy Spirit revealed to him. The Holy Spirit sent Jesus to that place, and he knew that that lady would come there. And that was, and in the beginning, he didn't say anything for the disciples to think, why is he talking to that woman, you know? Prejudice, you know? And then Jesus wanted them to understand, I came to save the whole world, not just the Jews only.
Thank you. One thing Jesus wanted to show the disciples, that plan of salvation has to be taken to all the places. Yes. That's one thing. Because also he wanted the disciples to break the prejudice and the Jewish arrogance. So he went there. You know, Jesus was very popular in Galilee because he was healing, he was preaching, and people liked them. Suddenly, he said, let's go to Tyre. And the Holy Spirit, as Mohan says, the Holy Spirit led him. And he, you know, Jesus went there just to deliver this girl of this Syrophoenician, just for that purpose. But Jesus does it a roundabout way. No, Jesus does not entertain that when the lady came there and asked, Son of David, have mercy on me. He didn't mind her. He walked away. Then she started bothering the disciples. And they tell them, Master, send her away. Master, send her away. She's bothering us, she's nagging us. Jesus doesn't say anything. So Jesus doesn't show any kind of change in their attitude. And this lady, again, fell down and worshipped her. Have mercy on me. You know. Then Jesus said, it is not right for me to take the bread of the children and give it to the dogs. What does it mean? Jesus used this word twice, that word dog. Well, I don't want to go to the other part of it. This part, we'll stay with this one part.
I just want to mention, Jesus knew the hearts of the people sitting around there in that room. He knew they were prejudiced, and he knew their thoughts. So he had to correct their thoughts.
Correct.
Well, the statement dogs in the Bible is used for people who go back to their sins. Mm. And so God knew that, you know, it's not really for them. It's even us,
yes,
believers,
yes,
that go back to their own ways of sinning is like acting like dogs that go back to their vomit. And so Jesus knew the prejudice of the people, and so he said, look here. And the disciples were really happy, we have to understand that. They were happy to hear Jesus rebuke the lady.
Yeah.
Because that's how they felt in their hearts. And so we have to understand sometimes
yeah,
when we
thank
rebuke.
You. Jesus was using the same way of, Jesus wanted the disciples to get rid of the way they think. Okay, how do we know this time? Yeah, yes, Pastor.
If he called them dogs, he called the Pharisees vipers.
Yeah.
So he has used a lot of terminology, sheep and goat and dog. And today many people are happy, you know, dogs are nice. So he was just using a general term so that people could identify.
No,
Gentiles see, were considered as dogs by the Jews. Mm-hmm.
The Jewish people considered Gentiles as dogs. Mm-hmm. So that's what Jesus was indirectly pointing that one to the disciples. That's not the way to do. Mm-hmm. And to bring the story to a close, she falls down and worships Lord. And she says, even the little dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. What does it mean?
Yeah, so the question, to rephrase, what was the meaning of the Syrophoenician woman's response?
Oh, women's word. Yes, Suraj.
We have to always understand a crumb from the bread is still bread.
Yeah, God, that's,
you know, it doesn't change the quality of what falls. And she understood that.
Okay.
So she said, even if you give me one crumb, you're still giving me bread. And she was willing to go for the crumb because she said, I want that bread.
The woman knew Jesus had the power.
Yes.
And that's why she worshipped him. But the rest of them were making fun of her and had prejudice in their heart. And they never believed Christ either. They never worshipped him. They didn't want to listen to Christ or believe in Christ.
The woman knew that only Jesus could help her. Nobody else. You know, I don't want to, there are a lot of things we can talk about that one, but the time doesn't permit. She knew he is the only hope she had. So she fell down in worship. When we don't have any hope, whom do we go? Whom do we are supposed to go? You know, you see, when I was working in the Johns Hopkins, we used to work on the missions, and sometimes the mission gives the problem, and there's a science on the mission. When everything fails, say a prayer. So this is what the lady did. She tried everything. Nothing was helping her to exorcise the devil that was possessed to her daughter. So Jesus was the only source. So she fell down in worship. And Jesus, when she said, even the little dogs eat the crumbs that fall from master's table. Jesus says, to this saying, go home. Your daughter is free from the devil.
Great is your faith.
Yes. So if anybody couldn't hear Auntie, he also replied to the woman, great is your faith.
See, the way we have to understand that little crumb that fell from the table was what Jesus called great faith.
Mm-hmm.
She wanted that crumb. Imagine if we have that same kind of faith like a mustard seed. You know, it's the same principle. That little bit that we have, God calls great faith. And he commends her for her faith, for the crumb, not for the whole loaf, just the crumb.
Again, so when Jesus quoted the Mosaic covenant, this lady was quoting his Abrahamic covenant. So this is Jewish people mostly, you know, they followed the Mosaic covenant. But This Syrophoenician lady was indirectly, I don't know whether she knew it or not. She was, using the Abrahamic covenant. So you cannot go without helping him. That's what she said. Okay, Pastor.
I just want to compare that woman to this woman. The church is a woman.
Okay.
And that woman was wanting for crumbs.
Okay.
And Jesus was, it looked like, apparently, that he was shooing her away. And she was just persistent. But here, Revelation 12 woman, he is standing at the door and knocking. He is persistent. And he said, I want to sup with you, not just crumbs. And we are shooing him away. What a contrast.
Jesus said, I am the living bread that came from heaven. Okay, I'm the manna. Okay.
So to summarize, basically, what we've all discussed here, Christ's ministry to Tyre and Sidon, I guess we can interpret in a way that he went and was led by the Spirit just to help this one woman. And it was her faith, we can understand, that led her here. And we learn also how great her faith was by this story. So that's where the lesson focuses on how Christ ministered to foreign places. We see he also goes into big cities as well. So the question that I have for the audience, anybody can answer, why was it so difficult for people in the big cities to accept Jesus? And I've been noticing all the questions have been answered here, so if we can have some people on the outskirts also, if they're comfortable answering, why was it difficult for people in big cities to accept Jesus?
Big cities, bigger problem, bigger challenges, mm-hmm. more temptation.
Mm-hmm. Big distractions, right? In the city people, they have no time for anything. So there are so much attractions that distracts them from from God, from their spiritual life. That's one thing. And it is in the history of cities, we see that God wanted to save the cities. And we know the story of Jonah. Jonah was sent to a city. Sometimes we think that we all have to run to the mountains to avoid the vices of the city. But there are people who long to be Christians and want to follow Jesus Christ and long to come under the plan of salvation. So there is a responsibility. Jesus went around and doing, healing the people, preaching to the poor, and he did a lot of things in the cities. When we read the Gospels, we see what he did in Jerusalem, Jericho, Capernaum, Nazareth, Bethsaida, on and on the cities. He went around doing things. But when you read Matthew 11, 20, he rebukes the cities.
Auntie Shushila, I think you had a comment.
I think the people in the big cities, they maybe felt self-sufficient and they have everything that they want and they don't need anything else to be taught to them.
Yeah.
So they felt that they didn't need a...
Busyness, not business. Busyness is Satan's invention. They keep us busy, busy, busy. So we will not have time to have a family worship or pray, read the scripture and meditate. We do not have all this kind of programs. I know when I talk to my children, they're always busy. Something else has to be done. See, this is what the city people, they are distracted by so many attractions of the cities. And Jesus wanted to take that message to cities also. Yes, Mohan.
Just as you mentioned, Dr. Matthew, people are distracted at this juncture, politically, economically, and all of social. People are distracted so much so they have no time to sit and meditate upon God.
Right.
Even a prayer. Because we are kept so, that is the devil's device. Keep them busy. Keep them busy. They'll not have time for Jesus.
Look at this Christmas time. People are running to and fro. And they are so busy this time. In the name of Christ's birth, they are busy. So when they are busy, they throw the Christ through the window, you know. That's what happens. So cities are a place where people have a lot of things to look for, and they don't have time to. So Jesus rebukes the cities, not because he hates the people in the cities, but because the attitude of the big cities, you know.
So then a question to the audience. As Elder Matthew pointed out, Christ did rebuke the cities, but what was his actual attitude? What was his heart towards these cities, the big cities?
Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophet and all that, we know that. How often I would have gathered you like chicken gathers chickens, young ones, but you would not. So it is the choice that we make. The God who blesses with all the blessings, we forget to recognize, to acknowledge, because we are so much deep in the cities, in the world. It's the deeper we go, the harder to pull out. I guess that is one of our problems in this world.
Yeah, Jesus wept over Jerusalem.
Yeah, and the Bible mentions multiple times he had compassion.
Yes, he felt compassion. Multitude followed him, even the cities, but he felt compassionate towards them. Mm-hmm. It is in the city he told, come unto me, all that you labor and heavy laden, I will give you rest. City people have no rest. Mm-hmm. You know, so we in the 19th century, America was industrialized. America was a rural society in the West. So people started coming to city. And there they work opportunities and started working. And slowly the shift work started. There are a lot of things we can talk about this. Shift work is the invention of the Satan. So he splits families. Husband works, wife stay home. Wife works, husband stay home. So there are a lot of things for city life, is the result of industrial revolution. And when people in this rural area, they have time for worship, the family together and everything. And that is one of the reasons the spirit of prophecy says that we'll have to get away from the cities in the last days. There's so much vices going on in the cities. Okay.
So we'll summarize. Basically, the message to the big cities is, while there are so many distractions, there is a need that's still in the big cities, and Christ had compassion for big cities when he was ministering on this earth. So we also should have that same attitude, that same heart and burden for the big cities that Christ had while he was on this earth. So our last few minutes of today's Sabbath School, we'll focus on Thursday's lessons where we learned three different stories. The first was the story of the centurion who went to Jesus on behalf of his servant. The second was the healing of the paralytic, and the third was the healing of the blind man. So in these three stories, the question I have is for Pastor Elder, what was the different responses that Christ gave in these three stories? Or even for the audience, if you recall, what were the responses that Christ gave? The stories were the centurion, the paralytic, and the healing of the blind man.
Great is thy faith.
Yeah.
Yes, I have not seen such great faith even in Israel. I believe that was to the centurion.
What did he say to the paralytic? Your sins be forgiven. What did he say? He could have just healed him.
The question, why did Jesus have to say, your sins are forgiven?
Would it be that he went to the source of the problem? Not just putting Band-Aid.
Mm-hmm. Oh, say it again.
To my knowledge, He went to the source of the problem.
Oh, source of the problem, yes.
Not
yes.
putting Band-Aid.
Yeah, because he knew sickness is the result of sin. Now, it doesn't have to be his sin, but all sicknesses is the result of sin. So that's the reason why Christ said, your sins are forgiven. That means, indirectly, he is healed. Okay, once the sin is out, you are healed. So, are we sick? Are we sick? Yes.
I think Pastor Pedrin had a comment.
Yeah, you,
To answer the question, another supporting view could be, Christ wanted to show everyone there that he is not only the healer of the body, but the healer of the soul as well. He's okay. The complete physician.
Yeah, that's a good point. Thank you, Pastor. See, when we see he heals two blind men, and he asked the question, what would you like me to do for you? And they said that we might see. That's very natural thing that they like to see. And Jesus heals them. They see. And actually, Jesus did not only open their physical eyesight, but also spiritual eyesight. We know that one. They rejoiced and they followed him. We read in the scripture, these blind people, they rejoice and follow him.
Jesus' first question to them was, what do you need? What do you want?
Yeah.
He wants to see if they want to be healed physically or they want to be cleansed from their sins. He always asked that question, what do you want? What do you need?
And also, if I may inject this thought, Psalm says, God looked down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there are any that didn't understand and seek God. They're all gone astray and become filthy. We all are sick. We need God to heal us in every way.
Any other discussion on this one? Okay.
Well, if you can go ahead and we're at the close of the lesson. Can you go ahead and summarize the lesson?
Yeah. From this, what are the takeouts from the lesson? They all have read the lesson. What are the takeouts? What we have to learn from? I'll summarize it. It's one thing, the salvation is open to all. Jesus took the disciple and told them what they have to do. Then, we also read about the faith of the people who came to Jesus. They have implicit faith that says that Jesus only helped them in this world. Okay? And in the case of the centurion, he was a very humble man, an honest man. And we have to be humble also. Now, if you read Hebrews 11th chapter, that is called the Hall of Faith, we see so many personalities who have the faith in Jesus Christ. And what does faith do us? Without faith, it's impossible to please God, Hebrews 11:6. And we see faith delivers. Faith honors. Faith heals. Faith saves. Faith strengthens our relationship. Faith is having patience with God. That's not in the Bible, but it's a different quote. Faith is having patience with God. In the case of the Syrophoenician woman, she was patient all the way. So patience, faith is having patience with God. We want things done in a quick way, but God has his own timing, and always it is good for us. So another thing we want to learn from this one, salvation is always individualistic. You cannot be saved as a nation or a church or a denomination. It is always individual. All these people are individual. Christ is a personal savior. So our salvation is personal too. So we need to know that the personal, we need to follow our personal savior. We need, then Holy Spirit leads us. No, faith happens unexpected place. Any place it can happen. You know, anybody, a lot of things. Without your knowledge, God works a lot of ways. So these are some of the things that we need to take from this lesson. Any other things you want to add? You want to add anything to the lesson that we just discussed?
I think we can go ahead and close
okay.
prayer.
So we'll have a prayer, closing prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this lesson. We thank you for the lessons that you have taught us through this lesson. We often think in our own way that is not the right way sometimes proved. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that leads us in everything. We want more of your Spirit in us, so that we might see things in the right perspective. Heavenly Father, thank you for being with us during this lesson study. And bless the class, and please be present with us in the coming divine service. And we want you to bless each one of us so that we might be your children. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.